stroll into Hinkle Fieldhouse is a walk into one of the true temples of college basketball. It's hosted the likes of Oscar Robertson and Larry Bird, and of course Coach Norman Dale and Hickory Huskers. But the old Fieldhouse was built for snowy afternoons like today, and terrific hardwood encounters like this one. From Indianapolis, welcome to the O'Reilly ESPNU Bracketbusters. And today, we bring you a pair of top 15 teams that could smash your NCAA bracket into a million pieces. Number 12, Butler, and number 15, Southern Illinois. Not only are the Bulldogs and the Salukis headed to March Madness, they could both win their leagues. Southern Illinois, the top dog in the Missouri Valley. Butler is battling Wright State for the Horizon League title. Welcome, everybody. Great to have you along. I'm Dave O'Brien, alongside Coach Rick Majerus. I don't know if Mr. Chitwood is going to make an appearance at some point here today. Maybe he will in the final seconds. But in both Southern Illinois and Butler, you have a couple of terrific mid-majors, and this game means the world to them.
Dave, I'll tell you what. Here's what's on the line today. No pun intended. The winner of this team will solidify its position as either a 3 or 4 seed in the NCAA tournament. Unfortunately, the loser will probably be relegated to 5 or lower. We'll talk more about that later, but that's an unbelievable swing of events for one of these two teams here today.
Let's give you a look at Star Watch. You may want to keep these two gentlemen in mind come March. You want to be familiar with Butler's A.J. Graves and Southern Illinois star Randall Fulker.
Well, Fulker patrols the paint and is the master of his domain down low. Graves, the focus, steely-eyed, three-point assassin, can't wait for the tip-off.
The Salukis play suffocating defense, but Jamal Tatum is a gifted three-point shooter, and Brian Mullins, an outstanding passer, he's the point. Butler's Mike Green forms a potent combo with Graves in the backcourt, and in the two lineups, just one sophomore. The other nine, all juniors or seniors, you know, the mid-majors, they keep their kids for 4 years. That experience has really paid off for Butler and Southern Illinois.
And additionally, to keep them 4 years, they've taken a page out of the Wisconsin Badgers and other teams. They've got transfers, redshirts, and therefore playing with older players.
Well, there's a look at Chris Lowry of Southern Illinois, the head coach in his third year, just 34 years old, a former Bruce Weber assistant. He has turned Southern Illinois into floor burn U. They get after it like nobody's business on defense, but Butler is at home in one of the historic buildings in college basketball. We are underway as the Salukis win the opening tip. Top at Shaw.
First to 50 wins. That's what I'm calling. We just came off of that great NASCAR.
Tatum.
I just see a temple here today that looked like your grandma at the grocery store with a shopping cart at some point.
Round the back, it's Mullins to launch his shot. First one of the afternoon. It won't go for Southern Illinois. And again, winding down that shot clock. Get used to seeing that today.
And watch Mullins pick up. He'll extend his pickup point over 84 feet. And they deny and go outside, 5 feet outside the three with great ball pressure. What's the ball pressure of the Salukis?
Petko, the 6'5 senior from Slovakia, up top to Ligon.
Their idea is to force you to drive and dribble to a shot, therefore taking away the three ball.
Shot clock at 5. Petko looking for some help. Got it off to Brandon Crone. Shot clock at 1. He hits the deck. Watching the practice of Todd Licklider and the Butler Bulldogs yesterday, he brought out the blocking dummies. He said, you had better be ready for physical contact because they're going to come at you and they're going to hit you.
And at the Southern Illinois practice, he told his guys, he actually tried to end practice twice because he was not getting the effort that he felt a game of this magnitude demanded.
Lowry's team plays such a ferocious brand of defense. Occasionally in practice, his teams will almost come to blows. Now, the refereeing crew today is Eddie Jackson, John Moore, and Mark Mayhood, and they're taking a look right now on the monitor. Just a little more than a minute gone here inside Hinkle, the building constructed in 1928. For 20 years after that, it was the largest basketball arena in the United States. Originally, it was Butler Fieldhouse. It was in 1954 when Tony Mylan High won the Indiana State title right here.
Now you see the defensive pressure as the shot clock winds down. Look at them extend their pickup point. They want to pressure the ball, force you to back cut, deny the passing lane, and then they'll rotate to your drive.
They're trying to see if there is a shot clock violation, but it certainly didn't look that way when the play developed. 1850. 52 remaining as we're just underway here in the first half.
Don't you wish we could all go back and check our work like that periodically?
1 second on that shot clock. And it's a knocked out of bounds. No foul on the play. Betko will try to get this in.
An interesting teaching point here. They do not pressure the pass or inbounds. They zone off the inbounder.
And a foul before the inbounds pass could be launched. That'll be on Brian Mullins of Southern Illinois.
Someone they can ill afford to lose, their quarterback and their best extended up court defender.
So that resets the shot clock at 35. Here's Brandon Crohn giving off to Graves to the foul line. Very dangerous outside that three-point arc. And now Green will set it up. Green, the junior from Philadelphia, really transformed this Butler team after transferring from Towson. Graves, his first effort. He's been hot and cold as of late and misfires on his first one.
Now, Butler, conversely, they defend territory. They back off. They try to zone you up. Coach used the term that yesterday. We're going to zone them up, zone them up. Not playing man-to-man, but they get off the ball and form a helping zone.
Let me get down to Shaw. Shaw in the paint. It's spit right out of his hands. Butler forcing the turnover. Julian Betko with it. Butler coming in number 12, but they were ranked ninth last week before losing to Wright State on February 10th. They have had a magical season thus far after that early run. They knocked off Notre Dame, Indiana, Tennessee, and Gonzaga on their way to the championship of the NIT season tip-off in Madison Square Garden. Green flips it up. Tough angle, but he made the shot. And Butler strikes first here at Henkel.
He had a body on. Not only was there a hand up on him, they were bodying him up.
Southern Illinois, the last time the Salukis beat a ranked team on the road was 1975. Fokker going hard. He's fouled with 17:27 remaining in the first half. And back to that hard drive by Mike Green.
See, they're up on you so much. Now watch him body up against Green, but Mullen can't get his second foul, and Green knows that. Plus, he's forced to drive because they will not allow a three-point shot today if they can help with the Salukis without making you put it on the deck.
Fokker, the 6'7", junior out of St. Louis. He's the team MVP in serious running for player of the year in the Missouri Valley Conference at 13.7 and a half rebounds. And, oh, by the way, leading the conference in block shots as well.
And speaking of that, last year he just dominated Patrick O'Brien, the first-round pick of the Golden State Warriors, and was the league MVP in the Missouri Valley Tourney. And this guy also did in D.J. White this year at Indiana. Keep your eyes on number 14, Fokker. He's an outstanding defender.
They can jump right through the rafters. On the backdoor, Green with the catch on the baseline. And able to get that one. No, he did not. He did not get the timeout. He was looking for that. But you have to have a foot in now in order for the timeout to be awarded.
And one of the rare passes being made today without the ball being pressured. Take a look at both these teams on their hands. Butler tries to get into you and out of you. Get in, get out on defense on the ball, where Southern Illinois just stays up on you. See, watch Butler get in, get out.
Tony Young can't find a range, the senior.
Remember that number I gave at the start, Dave? I said first of 50 wins. 4 minutes into the game and we're at 2-2.
Butler at 24-3 coming in, 11-2 in the Horizon League. They're in second place. Green to the baseline, but he's fouled. Fokker going for the block. But he got Mike Green with the personal. Talk about defense. It's going to be a watchword today here.
Well, you're looking at the opponent's points per games right here, but a lot of that's in conjunction with the type of offense you choose to play. Later on, we're going to talk about the true barometer, which is defensive field goal point percentage. But that foul on Faulkner is critical because he has to stay in the game. And you can see he squats down. He's so enthusiastic, so tough. There he is. He wants to put you to the floor with the block rather than just keep that ball in bounds.
I'm considered one of the most dominating big guys in the Missouri Valley. Green too strong. That's Fokker with the rebound. The Salukis have won 8 in a row. They've done it with the possession offense we're talking about, an excellent defense. They have held all but 5 opponents below 65 points this this season.
They're in the four-man motion here. They're trying to space the perimeter, keep it wide, look for Faulker.
Faulker trying to go up and catch it. He gets knocked around in the paint. Thrown with the foul. 3-2 Butler.
See, Faulker tries to call for the ball. Can you keep a body on you? But look at all those white shirts converge. You saw three white shirts and the fourth coming into the picture. Butler does everything by committee. They rebound by committee, defend by committee.
Tatum with a short jumper gets it to go. Jamal Tatum averaging 14 points per game.
He's their improv scorer. He's the one guy on their team that can go get his own shot whenever he wants.
And he's allowed to do that. Everybody else kind of has to stay inside that system. Braves with the lob. There's Green with a catch. One dribble down and kicks it back out. Braves was open for a split second. He will launch it, and it's around and out of the three-pointer.
That was wonderful execution by both guys.
Thrown jumping out to spoil the fast break basket. We have a timeout on the court. This is not a slow start. This is how both sides want it. And sold out Hinkle this afternoon. Saturday afternoon like this, that light pours through the south windows of this marvelous old building, bringing all sorts of memories with it. Southern Illinois on top of Butler. Place completely sold out. It's an arena that has seen John Wooden and George McGinnis and Larry Bird. Of course, Jimmy Chipwood is mentioned. And today, seeing Randall Faulker moments ago, a key play involving the Saluki star, Rick.
Well, you're going to see Green put the ball on the floor, which is what the Saluki defense does. Look at him get up on you and close out. Now, here comes Faulker, and watch him squat down. Referees call big arm movements. He makes body contact and arm contact. He needs to learn to come off your rear end with his inside hand to avoid that and block perpendicular to the floor.
Tatum trying to get around Graves will pull up and shoot. And here comes Green. Neither side really likes to run very frequently. Drew Stryker getting in off to Crone. He'll attack the iron and can't get the roll. Green keeping it alive, but Tatum came in to take it away from him.
He came from the top of the key to get that long rebound, Dave. That was a great call on your part.
Boy, do they attack and attack and attack. Talking about Southern Illinois, maybe the fittest team in the country. Young got it. A long range three.
Betko had a hand right up on him.
The Salukis with their biggest lead in the early minutes. A little bit of pressure here, but not much.
Now they got Graves bringing it up, and they move Green more into the context of the offense.
Betko off to Crone. Trying to match the three. Can't do it. Clemens with the board for the Salukis.
They're letting the right guys shoot the three. Crone's just an average three-point shooter.
Boy, Tatum high off the glass. Talk about his ability to create.
He can really move the ball wherever he wants to on the floor by virtue of the dribble.
Betko down the lane. They let him through, but he missed it. He could not convert on it.
Out of that timeout, the Butler coach told his players, look, you've got to break them down. You've got to drive it when they're that much reaching in. Now you see the Bradley defense keeping a cushion. Two guys in the paint converge on that. Every time the ball is passed to Faulker, you'll see at least one other Bulldog coming in the paint for Bradley.
And that was Betko coming over as Green is held up and fouled on his way through the lane. 13:49 to go in the half. And coming up later on ESPN2, the Bradley Braves facing the Virginia Commonwealth Rams at 8 Eastern. Then at 10 Eastern, it's Drexel taking on Creighton. It's O'Reilly ESPNU Bracket Busters on ESPN2 Saturday. A great one developing here, perhaps, number 15 against number 12. By the way, it's the first time ever that a nationally ranked Butler team is facing a nationally ranked opponent here at Hinkle Fieldhouse. It's never happened before today.
This guy's a 58% three-point shooter, Campbell.
Campbell with the miss. He's really developed into a big threat as the season has developed here for Butler. Tell you what, Southern Illinois traveled some fans. You can hear them from the rafters,
yeah,
chanting.
Coach said he thought he had about 1,000 with him.
Yeah, Chris Lowry was happy with the way his team's been traveling. And
I wonder
why
if
not.
Clyde Frazier's here.
Well, he is the famous Saluki, the most famous of the Southern Illinois alums, the great New York Nick. Backing down Tony Boyle, and they're going to wave that one off a traveling violation on the 6'8 sophomore. So the fans here at the former Butler Fieldhouse just delighted.
Now you see the Salukis' extended defense. They pick up, they don't press full court. They pick up right here at 84 feet. They want to wear you down and grind you the entire game.
Green using the Campbell screen, nearly lost his dribble, now has to pick it up. You can see the Salukis swarming at every opportunity. They just don't let you breathe. Green trying to spin into the lane. Campbell, shot clock down to 11.
They want to force you to drive. It'd be hard for Butler to get a three-point shot off here today.
Shot clock down to 4. Campbell on target with this one.
But if you're going to give one off, why not give it to the guy who's shooting 58% fade?
58% in league play. Beyond that arc for Campbell. He draws Butler to within 3.
Nice patience and ball control there by Butler.
Butler knocks it out. Campbell lining up the 3 just seconds ago.
You see him get it, puts it on the floor, creates space. He's not going to get it and not have to bounce it. He's going to have to deck it, and he does it wisely with a lateral dribble, an escape dribble as opposed to a penetration dribble. The subtlety of that dribble, Dave, created the space for him.
The Salukis will bring Matt Shaw off the floor and bring on Jamal Foster. He's a 6'10 junior from Columbia, Missouri.
A quickness upgrade, but what they're really looking to do here is rest players because they're so much out in the passing lanes with the dial.
Clemens, quick move to his right, sailing in, banks it in. They will count it, and he'll go to the line. An athletic play for sure by Wesley Clemens, the sophomore. This is his hometown here in Indianapolis.
Practice yesterday at Northwest High. Watch him take that defensive pressure there. They close out to him. He understands he's got a mismatch in terms of athletic ability, drives Graves. No regard for fear. Look at him keep his head up and play through that contact hit.
Campbell, the man with the contact, a three-point play for Clemens. He started Northwest High School right here in Indianapolis. That's where the Salukis practiced yesterday when they arrived in town. Because here inside Hinkle, Butler was working out at around the same hour.
And their women practice, and I think Walt Frazier was here.
Walt was getting a workout in. That's right. Everybody was here in preparation for this one. Number 12 against number 15. A huge mid-major clash this afternoon.
Look at them rotate.
Zipped into the corner for Green. Got it. A three-pointer on the money.
Now that was terrific execution by both teams. One team was rotating defensively. The other rotated the ball. Ball movement trumps player movement.
Usually that's Green's job to get that ball movement going. Averaging about 4 assists per game. He had 12 against Notre Dame earlier this season, but knocks down the big triple. Green tried to step into the paint, knocked away from him. Here's Beasley out in front to slam it down.
Lowry's holding his hand up, telling him to slow down the pace. Be patient. Let's grind our four-man motion.
Tell you what, Hinkle Fieldhouse holds the noise very well, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
Mullins kicks out. Up top, it's Clemens. Driving the lane again. Graves got a hand on it. He's the man that caused the tie-up on the deck. 11-11 left in the first half.
Here you're going to see Butler spaced, and they're passing. They go the end, one pass, the hockey pass, the spacing, beat the rotation. Now they decide to D it up and get that rare fast break. They throw up the defense, and right now they're in control of this game.
Southern Illinois on top of Butler, 12-11, although Butler's hit their last 3 shots. This is an O'Reilly ESPNU Bracket Busters game between Southern Illinois and Butler. And tonight on ESPN, the top 2 teams in the ACC will face off.
With the exception of Randall Falker, all 5 other guys in the Salukis, 5 of their top 6 players, averaged 33% or more from the three-point line. That's a telling stat, and we all know 33 from 3 is like shooting 50% from 2.
And of course, Butler shoots a ton of them too. Butler has shot 666 three-pointers. That's about 250 more than their opponents. That's just a number, but that's about 10 more per game.
Yeah, that is, and that's an overwhelming number. Watch them in their grill. I'll tell you what, you're knowing what kind of mouthwash these guys are used this morning.
The Salukis get up close and personal. Krohn backing down, and that one deflected. Looked like Faulkner got a hand on it. Indeed, he'll take credit for the block. That's his second. Tatum barreling right into Graves, but Graves will be charged with the foul.
Tough call on Graves. Here we go. We see shakes him. Graves is moving, though, and he has a right to that spot. That was a good call by the ref. As most of them are, retrospectively, when you look back, these games are usually incredibly well officiated.
Both Butler and Southern Illinois faced Indiana early in the season. Butler beat the Hoosiers by 5. The Salukis lost by 10. But while Southern Illinois easily handled Indiana State, in the last place team in the MVC, Butler lost to them 72-64 in an upset in December.
There is so much at stake in this game right here because, Dave, I really believe, again, the winner of this is guaranteed a 3-4 seed, barring some kind of meltdown.
Faulkner, with the shot clock winding down, couldn't get it to go off the jump pass from Tatum. And here come the Bulldogs of Butler.
And that's Paul knowing who you are. He wasn't one of those five guys shooting 33 from three or better, Faulkner. He's an attaboy guy, and he's got to recognize that.
The open man, it's Green. He won't shoot it. Butler so patient offensively. Graves finds another open man closer this time, and it's Ligon to dunk it down.
They're taking that pressure, that closeout, and driving it. The Salukis aren't doing a good job of bringing help to penetration, and that's not Graves' MO.
And I think that's what Chris Lowry wants to talk about. If he can hear himself think inside Hinkle, Butler has the lead by one. One of the unique aspects of this great old building, at 4 o'clock we tipped off today, and that sunshine can come right on through those south windows. Gotta love the feel of a field house, and this is a true one.
I played here with my Ball State team when I coached. It is such a thrill to be on this court. The whole Indiana High School section is on here. If you're coming through the north side of Indy, you're invariably going to play here.
Back in the old days, when Milan High won that historic game over Muncie Central in 1954, there were over 700 teams in the Indiana High School tournament that year, and they were all playing each other. They didn't classify and break it up that way, as Bone comes off the bench and knocks down a jumper for Southern Illinois. Joshua Bone, the freshman out of Nashville.
Indiana High School Association blew it, Dave. They had a unique thing. There was one champ that could have played out every year, and they wish they could go back to it.
Graves in and out on his long three, and Bone's there for the rebound. Joshua Bone, a youngster who's done a lot of winning over the years. Tatum right on the money with the three to pull up top. 17-13, and he has 7.
Right guy, right three, and that's the easiest three ball in the game, the rhythm up transition three. Tatum, for a terrific offensive start, does a great job of dogging Graves. He's a determined defender. Watch the hands of the Salukis players.
Green trying to drive around Mullins. Walker came over to help. Here's Krohn, a line drive shot. Ligon got the position, rebound, and let it out.
They got rebounding angles there. With no definitive blockout assignment because they have to come and help penetration.
Only one other time in school history has Southern Illinois been ranked as high as they are right now. Faulkner missing on the tip. They rose to number 15 back in March of 2004 as well. But that ranking on the line today against number 12 Butler. Thrown out high to Betko. Graves unable to get into a shooting rhythm quite yet. Krohn tries again. That one nothing but net. Brandon Krohn, the senior, for 3.
They're getting strung out, Dave. Butler's doing a great job of attacking penetration, bringing 2 to the ball. They change it and find the open man with the end one hockey pass.
Mullins at the head of the key. Under 7 minutes to play in the first half. Boy, is the crowd ever into it, too. As the place is sold out. Here's Bone again. And that one caught a little of that backboard and almost went in. Bone, who won 4 state championships in high school in Tennessee. Graves off the fake. Krohn left open again. Front outrim that one.
It is so physical under there. These guys are really bodying each other out for rebounds. They're just driving them out when they put a body on them.
No wonder the shooting has moved to the perimeter here. It's too dangerous in there. Tatum almost lost it. Found the open man with Shaw. He's fouled on the play. Great job by Jamal Tatum just to get off a decent pass. Betko with the personal.
This game is all about the three ball. Once Mullins throw that pass to Tatum in rhythm and right on the dime, that's the easiest three in the game. And now watch Butler. They're going to drive, draw, and kick. Here it comes to Crone. He spots up right there. Crone buries a three.
Scott, thank you very much. Butler on top here, 18-17. The officials just checking the monitors moments ago to see who the shooter should be. 6:17 remaining. And I mean, so few points, an 18-17 game with just 6 minutes to go to half. If you're just joining us here at Hinkle, you're saying, oh, what a lousy game. And boy, would that ever be missing the point.
No question about it. I'll tell you why, we should play Steppenwolf, get your motor running in the background. Because yeah. You know what the motor is running here? The defensive motor. These teams are really committed defensive teams. Their hands are flaying everywhere, and they're moving their feet.
Shaw makes a bolt. Matt Shaw turned out to be the shooter. This guy could really be a tough matchup for anybody because he can step outside and shoot it as well. Saluki's with a little token pressure there. And Southern Illinois back in the lead. We've had five lead changes already and one tie in the first half.
They're sending that pick in the backcourt, Butler. They got to run the guy defending the guard, bring it up into that screen.
Boy, Stryker with a tough angle underneath, could not convert. Southern Illinois bidding for their 23rd win of the season. The long distance shot by Shaw, and we mentioned it just a second ago. You got to come out and guard him.
He was Southern Illinois, that area player of the year at Centralia High School, winning his high school incidentally in Illinois high school basketball.
One of the very, very best. 22-18. The Salukis opening up a little bit of breathing room here.
Once again, 34, the best three-point shooter on the court.
Green trying to toss that one along the baseline and a whistle underneath. A foul here with 5:26 remaining in the first half. We look at three-point field goals. We expected this to be a big part of the story. And Butler, a 3-for-9 start. A team that relies so heavily on that. Here's Graves to handle it, one of the best three-point shooters in the country. Stryker out to Campbell. All sorts of rim. Somehow it fell off. In Hoosier country, those are supposed to fall in. Tatum now.
Rises off the dribble, decides to wait.
Shaw, the foul line, jump pass. Falker tied up, he's fouled. Randall Falker will go to the line, which is not usually good news for the Salukis, just 56% from there.
Look at Shaw's pass here. He has a presence of mind to pull up in a middle game, sees Folker. Stryker got a bad call there.
Yeah, he did. Stryker charged with the foul.
That might be a recognition call. You know, Folker's the class of the league, and Stryker's another guy. Matter of fact, a walk-on for 2 years, and then they gave him a scholarship. When I say just another guy, I mean that affectionately.
Walker held to just 3 points, but 5 rebounds. Has a couple of blocks as well for Southern Illinois. He's averaging 13 per game. Made them both look very good on those foul shots.
Now watch, as the ball goes in Green's hand here, he's going to get pressured. He should run him into this pick. They should set a pick here for him. They'll do it more in a half court.
Green jumps inside. Missed it. Had a great look.
So tired because he has to do it all. He is their glue guy.
Boy, Tatum inside of Hawker. I don't know how he missed that one either, but relentlessly pursuing it. Crone trying to save it goes tumbling into the student section.
Geez, those students should have caught him. They moved to 5. Get out of the way of this Lukey, not your own guy.
Southern Illinois will have it with 4:34 left in the half.
Look at Falker take that right back up. He didn't bring it down. He didn't have his eyes up. That's why he missed it. Ooh.
To Tatum. They'll fire it right away. Got an excellent look at the basket. His three won't go, and here comes Graves.
Reyes moves so well without the ball. Watch him. He's a whirling dervish.
Green very quick. His pass barely got to Graves in the corner. Shot clock at 19. Graves trying the lane. Not where he likes to live. Here's Green, though. And it's tipped up and in. And somehow Crone powering through all those Salukis. Got his fingertips on it. He has five.
Big time rebound. As good a rebound as you'll see anywhere today. To come from that far out that quick and have that kind of touch in traffic.
Stolen away by Green. He took it right away from Young. Green will set up a play here for Butler.
Green is so smart, governs tempo so well. How about your point guard? Green is also your leading rebounder at seven a game.
Liggett with a tough catch. His hook shot. And rolls in for him. Brian Liggett. And of the starters, by far the least likely to take a shot. He's only attempted 62 all year.
But you know why he felt confident? He's a smart kid. He knows Faulkner has one. Cannot afford to get the second foul. And Faulkner wisely backed off of that.
Butler scoring off turnovers. Southern Illinois has yet to do it today.
There's a four-man motion. Watch him converge with two guys.
Walker with the kick out. It's Young open. Yes. Nothing but net on the three for Tony Young. He has six.
Both these teams are masters of the end one pass. The hockey pass. The pass where you make the pass that leads to the assist.
Southern Illinois by five. Green bumping bodies there with Southern Illinois' number 32, Matt Shaw. He commits the foul. 2:38 left here in the first half at Hinkle Fieldhouse. Scott, thank you. Butler has not lost on this court. 22 consecutive wins over the last two seasons, but they're down five to Southern Illinois. Rick Majerus, let's go inside Southern Illinois and their N1 passing
attack. They're running their four-man motion around Faulkner. Here you're going to see Tatum, their leading scorer, pass the ball to Faulkner. Look at the nice spacing. The ball's going to come in. Faulkner's got it. All of a sudden, Graves turns his head, drifts corner. Tatum makes that N1 pass. There's no rotation out there to the ball, and you see him bury the three. That was beautiful. Faulkner got it, and when he saw Graves lose vision, Tatum spotted up, kicked it out.
And Southern Illinois ranked number 15, one of only 15 teams to have gone to the last five NCAA tournaments, and that's with the likes of Duke and Arizona, UConn, Kentucky, Wisconsin, Gonzaga. The Salukis trying to knock off number 12 on their home floor here this afternoon. Crone off the inbounds. Betko gives it up. Green will fake. Young came out to guard a crowd asking for a foul there. But on a day like today, you're not getting a foul on a little bump like that.
I don't know why they're shot faking Butler, because they run at him anyway. You don't need to shot fake. Just wait. Take that closeout as they build to you and drive it.
Sure, if Mike Green's going to be able to stand up at the end of the 40 minutes with as much work as he's putting in today, but he is the quickest guy on the floor.
And don't forget, Mullen and Tatum are coming up on him, and they're making him work 84 feet. You know, those great Celtic teams, everyone thought it was Bird, McHale, and I'm not saying it wasn't, but I'll tell you, the master of the defense is Danny Ainge on the extended pickup point, turning the ball in the backcourt, and not letting you get into an offensive flow. That's Southern Illinois' MO defensively. They take turns between Tatum, Young, and Mullen.
I adore your attention to detail, but I'll take Bird and McHale.
Okay.
If you don't mind, can they play for me? I know what you're saying. Liggett will step out here for Butler. And Todd Licklider's.
Yeah, you're right about that. Maybe the Mormons got to me. That's why I took Ainge. They wanted me to join up.
I think that Digger Phelps wish he had joined a lot sooner another group. 27-23. And the Salukis to walk it up here. Tatum finds Young, who's playing in his 130th game for Southern Illinois, and he's won 100 of them.
Now, he was first-team All-League last year, Young. He will not make it this year, but he is the toughest dog out there defensively, and I say that with so much admiration. I love his dogged determination.
Whistle inside the paint. This one will go against Butler with a minute 51 to go before halftime. And a personal foul on Mike Green. The Bulldogs can't believe it. And they're down by four. Ligleiter. Not happy with this call.
I'll tell you what, you're impeding the progress of a cutter, and you can't do that. The cutter has a right. You can't bump or chug the cutter. That was a good call.
Some would beg to differ inside Hinkle. As Fucker is in and out with a foul shot.
Barely a 50% three throw shooter.
And another quick whistle. Only 1 second went off the clock there. As was knocked out of bounds by Butler. And now Graves wants back on the sharpshooter, the 6'1 junior.
When Graves and Green are in together as they are now, watch how Green keeps that eye open for Graves.
Walker off the inbound, spins the other way, off the front rim, and it's stripped away, and here comes Green out of the pack. He wants to push the tempo of one of the rare times today, and they seal him off defensively. Now he'll fire it up and miss. Stryker keeps it alive, another chance now for the Bulldogs.
Green is pressing, he's trying too hard. He's fatigued a bit.
Right into a wall of Salukis there. So does Krohn. They nearly give it up. Shot clock at 19.
Watch the ball pressure in the hands.
Green spins left. Draws contact and is fouled, but they just won't let you get an easy layup, will they? Well, tonight, Tyler Hansbrough and the North Carolina Tar Heels try to stay on top of the ACC standings. They take on Boston College. Coverage begins with College Game Day, driven by State Farm at 8 Eastern. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV on ESPN at 9 Eastern. Also available in high definition on ESPN HD.
Walker's anticipatory, quick to the ball. I'll tell you what I attribute that in part to. He's a biker. He's a long-distance biker. He rides bikes a lot. And you can see that in his calves and the definition of his thighs.
A serious mountain biker. As Brian Mullins comes back on the court for Southern Illinois.
Fancies himself as an art connoisseur, too. He made the team go to an art exhibit. But I guess if he were talking, I'm on that team at 240. He is genuinely tough. Other than Young, their toughest player, I'd probably go to the art exhibit, too.
Green locks a rim, but it fell in for him, and it's a two-point lead for the Salukis.
The momentum here is swung to Southern Illinois. Let's see if they can keep it closed out. Guess where this ball is going to go?
It's about the fourth momentum swing, by the way, in the first half between these two.
Absolutely. That is a great call. This thing is on a pendulum.
Under a minute now. Mullins calling out a play for Southern Illinois.
A rare play. They're primarily a motion team. That's where that ball's going.
Walker.
In out again.
It's Young. Too short. Green battling for the rebound with Ligon. Great save by Krohn. They continue to fight into the corner. And Butler comes away with it.
What an extraordinary effort both these teams are putting on.
This is the floor burn game of the year. Certainly among the mid-majors. And a reach-in foul by Young stops the clock with 29 seconds to go in the half. So much hustle, and the fans love it here at Hinkle.
Pure adrenaline rush. That's what this is all about right here. They're going to go after that ball. Oh, wow, what a play by Tatum. Oh, he pulls him down. It's got a Worldwide Wrestling Federation look to it as well.
So it'll be Mike Green to the line. Chris Lowry on his sideline imploring the officials who did not make a call in that exchange. I'm kind of happy they didn't.
Dave, they're sitting in the rafters. Look at the standing room in the corner. They've sold this thing out. We haven't been to a Big East game this year that's been sold out.
And that despite a pretty gentle snow fall last night of about 4 or 5 inches. Southern Illinois to hold for the final shot.
Very
the first half. Here's Tatum. Got it!
Oh. Rhythm up three. You cannot absolutely allow that. He just rhythmed up and sized it up, and he's their best three-point shooter.
Timeout, Butler. Still time on the clock. .4 remaining.
Let him drive by and let your help pull. Look at that. Look where his hands are. Graves is looking for a pick. Your teammates will call the pick, son. You can't let the best three-point shooter on the opposition size up a three with short seconds on the clock. Oh, wow.
Total confidence by Jamal Tatum. Senior from Jefferson City, Missouri. He's a 41% three-point shooter.
We talked about how they had to close out the half. They just did it unless they have some type of foolish foul. But there's a Bobby Plug shot from half court.
maybe there is some magic in this old Fuel House before the half ends for the Bulldogs.
Looking back at Star Watch, Graves without a point, 0 for 3 from 3. Faulker has been very tough on the boards. He's also blocked several shots. But Tatum, the guy to stick the knife in right before halftime for the Salukis.
Well, Saluki defense is predicated on making you put the ball on the floor, and they've done that. But week after week, I've come on here and talked about you got to identify the three-point shooter, prioritize and make him bounce it. Southern Illinois has done a great job on that.
Let's check out the Missouri Valley. Southern Illinois leading the pack right now, but who else do you think is getting in from this conference, Rick?
Creighton will get in for sure. They'll take three, I think, and it doesn't go by conferences. They don't pick them that way, but there's certainly three deserving of this. The RPI of Wichita State's got a lot of work to do. They're going to have to almost close out on an 80% win basis. I don't think they're capable of doing that right now.
Time for a desperation heave. Inbounds play. All sorts of time for Graves to flip it up and miss it.
And nobody pulled the pick. I'll tell you what, Tatum got blocked.
Felt like a lot more than 0.4. Well, we had a tie. We had five lead changes. And at halftime, Southern Illinois leads Butler 30-25 as we go to Scott Reese in the college basketball halftime report. Here at Engle Fieldhouse making their way back to their seats, ready for what should be a terrific second half. It's our O'Reilly ESPNU Bracket Busters. And from Indianapolis, the Salukis of Southern Illinois holding a 30-25 lead over the home standing Butler Bulldogs. Dave O'Brien and Coach Rick Majerus with you, Rick. We expected it to be a hard-fought, physical, well-defended first half. It's exactly what happened.
Tell you what, we use that war analogy all too much in an industry awash with superlatives, but today it is applicable. These two teams have come out here and played hard. Take a look at this pick at the end of the half. Here you're going to see Graves bring it. Watch Bedko clock Tatum. I mean, he just knocks him to the floor. Look at Tatum there. He looks like Don King having a bad hair day. I mean, he really got bounced on that one, and that's been the type of game that we've had here. On every rebound possession, it's been a body like that.
Somebody put a body on the scorer as well, the guy running the clock, because that was more like 3 seconds for Graves to get off a shot there. He did not score in the first half, by the way. Faulker unable to get to that one, up and over his fingertips, and a quick turnover here. That's 7 for the Salukis. We look at the first half stats, and Rick, the one that jumps out at you, Butler with only 1 turnover.
That's the good and bad news of it. They've got to be more aggressive driving to the rim and get a couple of turnovers by commission, not omission, because they're getting pressured so much on the ball.
A whistle before the shot by Crone. Remember, Butler leads the country in fewest turnovers. Faulker picking up the foul here. That's his second. So Chris Lowry may be getting a little bit concerned here. Very fast foul in the opening seconds of the second half.
He is foul prone. He's foul prone on the offensive end as well, because he takes it to the basket so aggressively.
Graves looking for his first points. He averages 18 per game.
Look at Faulkner. He's an automatic double team to almost any penetration.
Graves on the baseline. A little shove there and a foul against the Salukis.
Another stat that jumps off on us is Graves have not hit a three, and that's and the reason being they make him bounce it every time.
His next three-pointer moves him into third place all time at Butler in triples, but he's still waiting. Mullins picked up the foul. Butler's Green with a good first half. He had 9 points. Give him 11.
And a great no call by the referee there. Once again, I'm a proponent of that cylinder cone under the basket like they have in the NBA. That's about the only NBA rule I like to see come over to this side of the ledger.
Hey, one other note about the first half. Southern Illinois, no steals, no fast break points, no second chance points, no points off turnovers. Shouldn't they be down by about 15? They had the lead by 5 at half.
But there is no statistic for good D except defensive field goal percentage, and that's what they do a superb job of.
Shot clock at 9. Tatum.
It's hard to quantify the defensive effort statistically.
Foul on Butler with that shot clock twisting down. And we'll go against Julian Bedko, although Todd Licklider applauding on the side. His team has won 22 consecutive games at Hinkle Fieldhouse.
I love the coach, but don't like his body language, because it's being conveyed to the team that they're maybe getting a shaky deal here by the refs, and they're not.
Another whistle. We didn't have this many whistles in the first 20 minutes as we've had in the first 90 seconds of the second half. 30-27 here.
And these are Missouri Valley officials, so that's interesting. But I want to tell you, Dave, I really believe this. I have not seen a Big Ten game I've done this year as physical as this game so far today.
I would agree. You and I cover the Big Ten every week. Young.
Oh, we love the Big Ten, but...
Backs it in. Nice drive there by Tony Young, the senior. You're very fond of it. He spent some time talking with these officials during a couple of those, you know, ticky-tack fouls in the first half. And I think they were really listening to the senior.
Well, they respect him. He's such a great defender. Tatum might be the best two-man improv offensive player that's a great defender in the country. You know, very rarely do you see a two-man. I thought that was on the way down.
But Parker gets credit for the block. It'll be his third.
Oh, what a change of pace. What a play by Tatum. Look at that hesitation, juke dribble, and he passed it right off the dribble.
And Shaw finished it with the slam, and this is the biggest lead of the day for Southern Illinois. They've come out of the locker room hot here in the second half.
They're so athletic, and they pressure so much. They've got to make them pay a price for Fulton being able to ring three in there and double everything.
17:35 to go, but again, A.J. Graves can't find the range. Falker, this was a questionable block, you thought.
Watch how quick he is off his feet. He's anticipatory. He's alert. His knees are bent. Well, I tell you what, I wouldn't want to have to make that call for a living.
No, they did not make the call. They called it a block all the way. Ligon hands off to Green. By the way, A.J. Graves was ill for the first half. As Green hits the deck, he's fouled. Graves a little bit sick to his stomach. He did come out to begin the second half in the starting lineup. Walker picks up his third foul, Rick. So this is the major development now for the Salukis, who have the lead, but their best player, maybe the MVP of the Missouri Valley Conference, in foul trouble.
Yep, last year he owned the Missouri Valley Conference tournament because of shot blocking, rebounding, scoring ability. He's going to go to the bench now.
Well, no choice here for Chris Lowry. He learned to coach defense under Bruce Weber. He's an assistant for Bruce.
Assistant for Matt Painter as well.
That's
and,
right.
You know, it'll be interesting to see how well he learned his lessons, because he's going to have a big decision. His biggest decision to have may very well be when to bring Faulkner back in.
Well, you think about the ramifications of this game. You mentioned the Purdue Boilermakers having a terrific season. Many now picking them to go to the NCAA tournament. The guys at game day were talking about it today. Remember, Butler beat them. And they have become, I mean, the bigger story here in Indiana than either the Hoosiers or the Boilermakers. And well, what if Butler loses here today?
And Notre Dame as well.
Notre Dame as well. There's Shaw connecting for a three. Matt Shaw upping that lead to 37-29. He has 10.
I credit Shaw a lot for developing that three. He's a manufactured shooter. You can tell he's got a labored release. That's just hours in the gym.
The lead at 8. 17 minutes to play. The biggest lead for Southern Illinois. Stolen away by Young. He took it away from Green and backs it away. Out of bounds, but back
Green
to
is
the Salukis.
Green is so tired. He has to do so much. Green is synonymous with blue. But how about a team? There's none other in the country, Dave, out of 330, where your point guard is your number one rebounder as well.
Number 12 against number 15. A big clash among the mid-majors here today. Two teams that can just disrupt your brackets like nobody's business come March.
Now look at Graves and the mismatch on Shaw. You've got your two guard. Look at Shaw underneath. Graves fight them with that front. They come to help.
Butler knocks it away out of bounds. And there are 14 seconds on the shot clock for the Salukis.
Well, it's an inappropriate game in some respects to follow NASCAR, but the speed aspects of this game are all on the defensive end.
Everything's slowing down here when we came inside on a snowy Saturday. Tatum tried the high glass and missed it, and it's Campbell with the rebound. It's really interesting, too, that two of the three games Butler has lost, to Illinois, Chicago, and to Wright State, came to opponents who blew... Who they blew out, got big, big wins against. They had a 26-point win over one, a 31-point win over another. Foul along the baseline. That was 16 seconds on the shot clock. Graves, you can tell he is not himself here. Unable to score it.
And the fall chronicling Butler's success. in the state of Indiana. They owned the state until they lost to Indiana State.
Tatum picks up his third foul. He's going to head to the bench now for the Salukis. Clemens in for Southern Illinois.
That's a big loss because he's the one guy who will get a shot off the dribble and create anything he wants, Tatum.
Crone hit the deck. No foul when he launched the three. It's off Young and out of bounds. It'll go back over to Butler. We have a timeout. 15:58 to play. Southern Illinois looking to knock off Butler.
Dave.
Scott, thanks. Back inside Hoosier Country. And this landmark of a building, Hinkle Fieldhouse, where they shot the 1985 motion picture Hoosiers. Inside what is now the Dog Pound. And harking back to the days when it was the Butler Fieldhouse. Butler really owns it, but 22-game home winning streak. Tied for sixth in the NCAA. That goes back to last year. They've won all 12 home games they've played here this year.
And strategically here, Dave, you're going to see they're going to put pressure on the man.
Off the inbounds. Campbell knocks it down. We talked about how dangerous he's been for three-point land in conference play.
58% three-point shooter. He's the most impressive shooter on the court.
Bringing the Bulldogs back a little closer. Down five now to the Salukis.
Nice call to timeout by Coach Licklider and great execution by his club.
Young trying to answer, can't. The rebound on the baseline, a tough play by Wesley Clemens as he gets fouled. The 6'3 sophomore out of Indianapolis.
Well, there's an axiom in the Pro Bowl that the inbounder is the most dangerous guy. There they set that double staggered screen for him. He comes in, rhythms up, and if you watch his feet, he squares his feet as well as any big guy I've seen to the three-point shot.
Graves fouling Wesley Clemens. He knocks down the first one. And back on Drew Stryker for Butler as Crone steps off. Clemens going to high school locally. Same high school that produced 2006 first-round NBA draft pick Rodney Carney, who went to the 76ers. That was Northwest High. And for Clemens, to be practicing in his old home gym here in Indy yesterday. Here's a throwback. Here's Green into the offensive zone. Butler with it, trailing 39-32.
They pick up so high. I don't know why they don't set a pick in the backcourt like they did at the end of the half.
Green's floater misfires off to the right.
What Southern Illinois' defensive pressure's got him to do is speed up.
Young, a little wild there. Lost possession. Ah, Graves calling for the timeout so he would not be charged with any violation as he gathered in the ball. Timeout Butler off that vicious collision. It's been that kind of day, even though Graves is not feeling well. He's mixing it up.
We're on ESPN, Dave.
Scott, and here inside Hinkle, they love the Butler Bulldogs. They love their Super Bowl champion Indianapolis Colts, and they also love the effort by A.J. Graves.
Watch Graves here. Watch, he has a presence of mind to save the ball, dribbles it in, calls a timeout, and he's feeling really nauseous, too.
But back in the mouthpiece, it's been that kind of the day. Everybody better have one handy.
Now watch him pick up here. Look at Mullins get into him. Now they're up on Green, Young. They need to set a pick here and give him another bell ringer so that pressure gets off of him, maybe.
Let's see if Graves can get going. Assuming he's feeling well enough. Averaging 18 points a game, scoreless so far. Campbell continues to rain threes.
What a great call out of the timeout by the coach. They had a little dribble weak one, and then all of a sudden Campbell caught Shaw asleep. Campbell, Dave, is the best I've seen this year yet at setting himself to shoot. He has an incredibly quick release, which is all lower body.
Averaging 9 a game coming off the bench could be a big factor today. Shaw backing down his man, but he's tied up. He has fouled before the shot, but back to the last Butler hoop.
What you're going to see here is that dribble weave's coming, and now all of a sudden, something back picks, pops. Look at that. Look at his shot reception. He's got his shoulder over his toe, his hand target's ready, and his feet aligned. That's economy of motion to the nth degree.
Shaw stripped on the inbounds feed. Green reaching in.
2 miles down the street, Reggie Miller never did it better than Campbell did. They did it the same. That's what's so great about this game.
Campbell with 9 points, matching his season average. Shaw to the line.
You see a shot of the crowd here. They were selling standing room tickets. They sold well over 500 for cash.
just a few inches of snow, maybe 3 to 5 inches overnight. That's nothing for these folks to get here to Hinkle for this showdown between number 12 Butler and number 15 Southern Illinois, a mid-major clash here in Indianapolis.
Playing without their two studs, Folker and Tatum.
Shaw making one of two. Stryker rising up for the rebound.
Now see the pickup point extended here. Look at Young get in on him. He's pressure him, and he'll get a steal. Back door, good call.
Beasley bouncing for Graves. Off to Green. So far, Butler unable to cut into the halftime lead of five. Green up, and he rejects Graves there. It's going to be out of bounds off the Salukis with 14 on the shot clock.
Whenever there's any penetration, you're going to see it here. Watch Southern Illinois come and force him to another pass. They come and swarm the ball. So you've got him. If you can make that next pass, you've got him 4-on-3 somewhere else.
Big block there by Tyrone Green, the 6'3 junior.
Stand up.
Inbounds, not this time for Campbell. Although that's worked so well here in the second half.
They called his number consecutively on that same play. Burn me once, shame on you. Burn me twice. That theory. Burn me once, shame on me.
Clemens well away from the basket to Mullins.
Four-man motion, spread, spaced. They're trying to get it inside.
Not much progress, though. The shot clock's at 8. Clemens, one dribble now, jumping in. Tough pass to Green. He'll lay it up and in.
They are great short angle passes off of penetration. As a team, they make that interior short angle pass so difficult to make and even more difficult to catch. So I'm so impressed with both these teams.
That was Tyrone Green, by the way, going back to his left hand. He shot right-handed until 2 years ago. And now using the left to knock down the basket. That one will roll out. We'll go the other way. And tonight, Tyler Hansbrough and the North Carolina Tar Heels try and stay on top of the ACC standings. They will visit the BC Eagles. Coverage begins with College Game Day, driven by State Farm at 8 o'clock Eastern.
What about Mike Krzyzewski's animation after that Boston College victory? I didn't see that animated in 2 or 3 national championships he won.
Out high, it's Young with Graves guarding him. The Salukis up by 7.
Green is very tired, too. Very fatigued for Butler. This is a coach's son right here, Mullins, and he plays like his dad's a high school coach and an AAU coach.
The sophomore, their best passer, Clemens, off target. And the rebound, Green gets tied up in bumps.
You don't think that was one of those air ball passes?
You tell me.
No, it wasn't.
Only missed by about 4 feet. And foul number 3 on Betco.
He's kicking his leg. They caught him. What a catch on a missed shot. And there again, you see another short angle pass.
So Matt Shaw racing toward that lane. And the inbounds by Mullins. Green able to make that catch over Graves. Young. Ugly looking shot. Shaw for the rebound. Will give him another chance. And a new shot clock.
2 consecutive rebounds. New clock.
The Salukis winning the hustle battle. Young on the drive, the leaner. Shaw tipped the rebound to Green, and he lays it in.
They're all over that glass.
Don Butler in need of a timeout, perhaps. 12 minutes remaining. They have fallen behind 44-35. Biggest lead of the day, and they turn it over again.
Green is so frustrated. Green is in Southern Illinois. After they pulled and restarted the shot clock off of 2 consecutive rebounds, coming up now, you're going to see them get all over the glass. They have ball movement. They're in motion. They drive it. Look at that. Right there, they keep the ball alive. Shaw. Look at Falker.
On the bench in foul trouble, but cheerleading big time for Southern Illinois. We have a break, and Southern Illinois is on top, 44-35. Scott, thanks. Butler in a bit of a danger zone because SIU suddenly has its biggest lead of the day up to 9. And even though they've had a spectacular season so far, nobody has to remind Butler they're a small mid-major in the Horizon League where nothing can be taken for granted. You'd assume they're going to the NCAA tournament. Right now, the number 12-ranked team in the country. They go back to 2002, a Butler team regarded as the most talented 25-4 going into the conference tournament. They lost to the number 8 seed Wisconsin Green Bay in the first round, and they were denied an NCAA tournament bid. Let's go back now to the tournament resume for Butler.
They're in the tourney for sure. What they're playing here today for is a 3-4 seed Butler in Southern Illinois. Now you're going to see the staple of the Saluki defense, extended full court pressure right into him. I thought that they may want to set a pick and get it off. Look at Mullen all over Graves. That wears you down. Distorts your timing a little bit.
Here's Graves. Thought about the open long distance shot for a moment.
They are in your grill. They know your mouthwash, your toothpaste.
Into the backcourt. That's going to be a violation.
And Dave, here's the most telling point. They're up by 9, and they were only up by 5 when their two best players, Faulkner and Tatum, who are now coming to the game, went out. They've increased the lead with Faulkner and Tatum on the bench.
So the Salukis hold the hammer right now. Still plenty of time for Butler on the home floor. But for the most part, Southern Illinois has also taken the big crowd out of it. 44-35. The number 15 team in the country has the advantage on the number 12 team. Mullins with a little jump pass to Young.
Look at this. They're going right into Faulkner as they should.
Beasley, tough defense, knocks it out of bounds. The freshman sticking right with his man. Faulkner and Tatum, the two top players for the Salukis. 14 points, but 6 fouls combined, and have spent considerable time on the bench. Mullins trying to shred that defense. There's Beasley again with the block on the Young shot. As that one rolls out of bounds and back over to Southern Illinois, but suddenly Beasley is lifting his team.
You know what I loved about Beasley? I watched how subs come in the game. His mind was in the game before his body. He got off that bench with bounce, and so far has done a terrific job defensively.
Faulkner off the inbounds is fouled. He'll go to the line to shoot. Randall Faulkner, the junior out of St. Louis.
He just manhandles the once walk-on Stryker, who after 2 years was finally awarded the scholarship this year.
Stryker, his third foul.
You're talking about a guy here at the line who destroyed Patrick O'Brien last year from Bradley, first-round draft pick at Golden State. And then went right after D.J. White at the start of this season in the Indiana game. This guy's a tough customer right here. He's legitimately tough. A lot of these guys are Mr. T-tough. They're so tough. This guy here has got the real deal. Him, Tatum, and Young.
Faulkner pretty much on his average at the line. Makes 1 out of 2. Julian Betko coming back on for Butler. And finally, Green gets a rest. You know, he's going to be back on soon enough, though. Will not be a long respite for him.
And a 10-point lead in this kind of a game here might as well be an 18-point lead with the way they run the shot clock down.
Graves mishandling the dribble, but he's also fouled from behind by Young. He had Graves in trouble.
Look at how tired Graves is. Graves really is sick and woozy. Part of it may be Southern Illinois, part of it is himself. You can see, he looks to me like he might have a little fever.
Yep, we were told that sick to his stomach in the first half. He is 0 for 6 from the field, 0 for 3 from three-point land. That'll make him ill as well.
He doesn't need me to give him a bailout. He's a warrior, but he's being beaten up. Southern Illinois is a superior athletic team on the floor by far.
Have you seen a more fit team all season long? Jay Billis talked about this on game day today. He thought Southern Illinois was the fittest team in America.
Well, it begins with Faulkner being that bike rider. I'll tell you what, maybe he'll go tour de France.
Graves missing a foul shot. Well, that's the indication that he is not right.
And look at him carry his leg limping.
He is the best foul shooter in the country at 96%. Rick, he had made 59 of 60 on this court coming into today. Just the second one he's missed at home. There is no question.
But you're at home and it's no time for a bailout.
Tatum with a fadeaway. It's going to bounce and fall off the iron.
So physical underneath, as I said. Much more physical, and I'm not disparaging the Big Ten. I love the league, but I have not seen Big Ten players be as physical as this game here today.
Graves finally cashes in his first three-pointer. He is now third place all time at Butler in three-pointers made. Mullins forcing the action the other way for two.
And that three-pointer came off a ball pick. See, right now they're in Granger's shorts right here. Give Mullen a headbanger. They've got their best player, Green, on the bench. That's a need of a rest.
Brown, put that shoulder down. He draws contact there. Now Falker tumbling into the student section. And he picks up number four.
He just rides him and swats. He's such a competitor. He wants to give him that oomph at the end. Take a look at this ball pick coming. Here's Graves. Dribble to the left. There they set the pick. Boom, he's open.
But those, his first 3 points of the game, about halfway through the second half. Now, Falker heading to the bench with four personals. Really, though, when he's been on the bench, Southern Illinois hasn't missed him all that much. Well, and he's their best player.
That point by Billis is well taken.
6 points for Crone. One of the three seniors in Butler's starting lineup. Now somebody said it's tempting to think about the Butler kids as cast members from the movie Hoosiers, because it's true. They mostly come from small towns, and they are, like Crone, true student athletes. Nine of them have GPAs of 3.25 or higher.
Yeah, there's a lot of doctors and lawyers out there. And Butler has never had an NBA player, Dave, in the history of the team.
Right now, they need shooters and rebounders.
Right. Well, they rebound by committee, and as I said so often, when your point guard Green is your leading rebounder, you know you're void of athletes in size. And that's not, and that's acknowledging Green for the great competitor he is.
Mullins able to draw the foul. That was just 6 seconds left on the shot clock. Brian Mullins doing some good work, the MVC Freshman of the Year last season. Will go to the stripe for the Salukis. That's foul number four on Bruce Stryker.
His dad must be very proud. He's the son of a coach. And as a coach, you always hold those kids to higher standards. You may not mean to, but subliminally you do. And this kid's lived up to every expectation Coach Lowry or his father could have had for him. I really like this guy's mettle.
Was there ever a situation where you had the son of a coach on any of your college teams?
Yes.
And he wasn't as easy to coach as everybody else?
Son of a coach was a kid named Nick Jacobson. Great competitor, and his father was a terrific player.
Stryker, great save. Drops it out to Campbell. Beasley will start it now. Over to Green, who's back in. Here come the Bulldogs, trailing 48-39. Graves off the fake. Gives it up. Campbell is open. He got it.
What a great shooter. And Graves' head fake drew the second defender to him. But credit Green with having the presence of mind to get it to Graves.
Salukis need a timeout.
Lowry just went back to his guys and jumped them big time. He's all over them for their defensive transition, not getting back and not communicating as well he should. That was a terrific timeout, not waiting for the 8-minute TV timeout. Take a look at Stryker coming up on this hustle right here. Look at that. Now you saw Green make that pass. There's a shot fake. Takes two to him. Campbell with the range. Gets his homework done early there by his shot preparation before he even gets the ball.
And this big crowd in Indianapolis serving notice. It is not over yet. Even though the lead had gone to 10. 48-42 as we look at the three-point field goals in the second half. And finally, A.J. Graves has been able to connect. Part of the 7-3 run by Butler over the last 2 minutes.
Two things here, Dave. You can't be too tired to win at home, and you got to forget about these rest being from Missouri Valley. I think they have that little bit of a bugger do. Coach Lipletter seems to have sat down and not been so frustrated with him, and I think that's carried over to his team.
Well, Southern Illinois from the Missouri Valley, the top team. The foul before the shot by Tatum. The foul on the floor with 8:03 remaining. Butler playing at home here today. Horizon League and currently in second place behind Wright State.
Tatum has that fast twitch fiber that the kinesiologist referred to. I want to tell you something. He's like an NFL cornerback in terms of his foot movement laterally and his speed running and his quick first step.
Well, an excellent student in his own right with a 3.64 GPA, but did not get that foul shot to go, and it's 48-42. Butler down, but with the ball.
The two best players, Butler and Tatum, are both out of Missouri.
Here's Campbell again. Nothing but net.
They got to find out who's wearing number 34, because he was shooting 58% coming in, and I guarantee he's over 60, 63, 64% right now.
Well, he's 5 out of 7 from three-point land this afternoon. It's a three-point game. Young. Bracketbuster of the day, number 12 Butler on the comeback trail against Southern Illinois, but was this a foul?
Look at Tony Young drive. Beasley goes up, perpendicular, gets all ball. And I'll tell you what, I agree with him on this one. It looked like the ref was a little bit too trigger happy there. Let the players decide.
Yeah, assuming that it would be a foul, Young going to the line. He certainly did get hit on the forehead a little bit after the block. So Young here at the stripe, an 84% foul shooter.
The stat I like about Young, first team all league last year, no chance to make it this year. The scoring went down, and his play and what he's meant to his team have gone up. Take a look at his defense on Green right now.
Oh, but they're going to get him for a foul. Maybe a makeup there.
If there is such a thing, and the referees will always say it's not, but Dave, I'm with you. You called it just like a coach, and it was, in fact, a makeup call. There's no foul there either.
That's number 3 on Young. A little grin there from Tony.
Now I would like to have seen which coach was in that guy's ear who made that call. My guess is it was Coach Licklider.
Butler, Green at the line, 49-46.
Coming down to the wire. We said first of 50 wins. It's much more high scoring than I had anticipated.
A two-point game coming up on 7 minutes left.
Oh, here come 13,000 strong. Standing room at all. We've got them stepping up out of the wheelchairs to applaud.
They are practically hanging on the rafters here inside Hinkle Fieldhouse. On the drive, Shaw drawing contact. He is a tough matchup. He has shown that all day long. And the junior draws the foul. That personal will go against Pete Campbell, his second.
He looks a bit robotic. I want to tell you something. He's a very savvy player and a guy who understands being decisive on driving the closeout. As that defense builds to you, his decision-making today on whether to shoot or drive it has been not without fault.
Shaw, too short. He's at 83% from the line.
Again, the Saluki's leading scorer, Falker, on the bench. Four fouls. When they bring him in, is why Lowry's getting the big bucks.
How long do you wait?
He knows his team better than I do in this situation here. I'd wait till after the TV timeout at 4, to be honest with you. Unless the game gets away from him.
Shaw makes the second in, so Southern Illinois leads by 3, under 7 minutes to play.
With that foul situation, you compartmentalize it and correlate it to television timeouts.
There's Campbell, the hot hand for sure. He has buried 7 threes. Here's Graves now. Shot clock down 18. Green, on Green, drives left. Shot clock at 8. The bounce inside for Beasley. Difficult angle, and he'll be fouled and go to the line.
Campbell made a very good pass there and a great decision. They closed out on him, and his height of the bounce pass was superb. Look at Campbell. He brings that bounce pass so it doesn't come at him. It comes up to him.
key man in some foul trouble. Tony Young with his fourth for the Salukis. Mike Green.
Young is their best defender. Tatum's their best creator. And Butler is their most valuable player because he shores it all up inside. Faulkner now.
All three of them are going to spend considerable time on the bench, and Faulkner is up and heading for the scorer's table.
Lowry's just told him, do not get your fifth foul.
Green made the second and a two-point lead. Faulkner back on. He has seven double-doubles this season. He's been on the pine a good hunk of the day, but he's on here.
Specific to the situation.
Timeout Butler.
Stryker was on him. He's a walk-on, given a scholarship. He hung out and helped too long, and the pop gets separation to the shot. But take a look at it right here. See, he doubles that. Stryker, he didn't switch. Green tries to recover. He was trying to help out. He hung too long. He's got to understand he's a hot hand. He's a pick-and-pop player, and he's proven already today by two previous threes that he can hit the shot.
He has 15 this afternoon, and coming up later on ESPN2, it's the Bradley Braves facing the Virginia Commonwealth Rams. That's at 8 o'clock Eastern. Then at 10 Eastern, the Drexel Dragons take on Creighton. It's the O'Reilly ESPNU Bracketbusters on ESPN2 Saturday.
Stryker is just over in front of us, beating himself up. He knows he made a big mistake, but you got to love the kid's heart.
Trying to inbound in. It does come into Green.
Now here's that full court pressure. And now they got another guy on him, Mullen. They had Young on him. They got Mullen on him. They had Tatum on him. They keep fresh blood on him. They can bring that baby up with pressure over 84 feet every possession.
Green finds Graves, but there's always a man with him right on his hip every time he touches it. Thrown to the lane. Lays it up very sweetly for two.
And that's what you have to do against their closeout. You got to decisively drive the closeout and break that pressure down.
Brown, really the fire and brimstone guy for Butler, gets them to within three. Mullins using
going to try pick and pop again.
Mm-hmm. Tatum outside.
See, when Mullins is involved, he's not really looking for the shot.
Boy, Tatum hitting the deck quite hard as he shoved to the floor. Foul 5:25 left.
And Dave, talk about NASCAR. This guy's got warp speed. This Tatum is every athletic ability in the world. I mean, that acceleration off the dribble right there.
Braves with the shove. Tatum at the line. He has 10. Pretty good free throw shooter normally for Chris Lowry. 76%.
We're seeing excellent shooters this year because the pressure in this game is so big.
Southern Illinois leading by four. Remember, Butler has a 22-game home court winning streak here at Hinkle. The backdoor. Green lays it in off the feet from Strikers, not beating himself up anymore.
No, he's not. Beautiful pass and a nice back pick by Crone.
Has made their last five shots, Rick.
Back pick, back door, and drive a closeout. That's what you want to do against pressure.
Tatum trying to work on Graves. Nearly lost his dribble. Under 5 minutes left.
Such an athletic mismatch for Graves. He's done a good job. Oh!
Graves with the foul, trying to contain Tatum again.
I think it's a no call. I'm not calling that. I'm letting the players decide. Officiating either. He's moving laterally. Gosh, that seems like a tough call. Here we see the back door. Look at Green come off this back pick here by Crow. Nice pass by Stryker. Wonderfully executed play called by Coach Licklider.
Tatum at the line because of the fourth foul by A.J. Graves. And Graves is going to stay on. He just turned and said to Todd Licklider, I'm okay. I'm going to hang in there. Floor along with Crone, Beasley, Green, and Graves.
And that's a great call by you because
it's twofold. It's, he said, I'm not sick enough that I want to come out, and also, don't take me out with four fouls. I'm not tired. I got a timeout coming here.
It's a lot of trust for a coach as well. Reed taking it all the way to the right corner. Here's Campbell again. Tatum came out to guard him quickly. Reed spins out to Graves. Here comes the three. Just has not been able to find a range today. He's had a very tough day shooting it. One out of eight.
And a hand up on it. They've done a wonderful job of pulling off to him. He does not shoot on Federer under any circumstance.
The roof would have come off this place, this old building, constructed in 1928, had he knocked that one down. The last time Butler had a lead, there were about 6 minutes left in the first half. They led 18-17.
Whoever's building the arena should come here and just replicate this one.
Tatum swishes it. His fall away, sweet as you please.
Crossover, change of pace, dribble off of 1 foot. What a big shot.
He has 15 points, 5 out of 9 for Jamal Tatum.
Well, we talked about it. He's the one guy in the court and go out and get his own shot. And he just showed us how.
He's also a candidate for conference MVP. Campbell finally misses. The baseline here with 3:26 remaining, and it's Southern Illinois with the lead, 58-52. Everything going their way. Butler with the foul. Tatum with the fall away. Nothing but court. Bob, thank you very much. Well, AJ Graves may be the king for Butler of the 3-point shot, but they certainly need the king to come up big in the last 3:26. Here at Hinkle, Clemens will go to the line now for Southern Illinois. Graves, by the way, has made only 1 3-point shot today. 1 on 5 from the arc. Clemens, a sophomore, knocking down a free throw to extend that lead to 7. Coach, when you look at the things that Butler has to do here down the stretch to overcome Southern Illinois, what's number one on your list?
I'm going to try to get that pressure off me a bit. Run some pick and pop, perhaps.
Reach in foul by Green. He tried to slow down Campbell, who's been so dangerous from beyond the three-point line.
No way you want to stop that clock with 3 minutes to go and an 8-point lead on a foul on the entry pass, 28 feet from the rim, and here comes Faulkner.
Faulkner wanting to report in. It'll be Campbell at the line, 3:16 to play.
As we go to both practices yesterday, it's interesting. Butler embraced the underdog role, almost cultivated it, whereas Southern Illinois has had a swagger about them. It's kind of myth that they're classified a bit as a mid-major, pardon me.
Campbell with another one coming here. Southern Illinois with great credentials. They have won the last 5 Missouri Valley Conference titles. They have gone to the last 5 NCAA tournaments. Campbell will take a seat.
They put Beasley in a better defender because they have to get a stop here. Beasley's done a nice job for the Frost coming in. He's got Tatum right now.
Beasley right number 21 guarding Tatum. Shaw has had such a solid game up top to Mullins. Tatum just took a big spill on the baseline. And now bumped by Beasley, who's trying to contain him. Easier said than done. 2:55 left. And one of the great scenes in all of college basketball. It's the historic Hinkle Fieldhouse here in Indianapolis, Indiana, right in the heart of Hoosier country. Coach Rick Majerus, Dave O'Brien with you. A major clash of the mid-majors. Number 15, Southern Illinois, and number 12, Butler. Rick, you talked about this earlier. You feel 100% that whoever wins this game and closes out strong, that team has a great chance at getting a top seed.
They should be afforded a 3 seed. At least, I think, and quite possibly a 2, to tell you the truth. I am so impressed with the quality of play today by both teams, and also in this arena here. Every nook and cranny is crammed.
Tatum knocks it down, 62-54. And the crowd pretty silent at the moment.
Gosh, he's a talent. Both those guys, how about the 2 best players are from Missouri again?
Whistle here with 2:44 remaining.
See, now you ask me what I'd do. I would drive like that, get to the foul line, get him off my back, and then look for a 3.
Now Faulkner heading back to that scorer's table. He's been trying to get into this game for a while. The foul on Wesley Clemens to send Graves to the line. One of the big stories has been A.J. Graves with only 3 points all day. And one of the top players in the Horizon League at 18 points per contest. Here comes Faulkner again. And Green will sit now for the Salukis. Young is coming back on with four fouls, replacing Clemens.
I love Young. I love his temperament, his demeanor, his unselfishness. You'd think a guy who was afforded first team all league last year by the coaches. He's only averaging 9. He's up around 15 last year. He doesn't care. He's all about whether you're in the left-hand column tomorrow morning. He defends unbelievable passion. And Tatum does as well.
Now Southern Illinois has been in that column 22 times on the season, trying to run their winning streak to 9 in a row. And on the verge of snapping Butler's 22-game home court winning streak. Tatum, he's doubled up and fouled by Graves. And for A.J. Graves, that will be the day he has fouled out.
I would not play this game without either a split crew.
His brother Matt, who's an assistant coach for Butler, none too happy.
And his other brother, they all played high school ball, all three of them. Consistency of some of these calls are getting me, and as you know, you can't, I'm a guy who's a referee advocate, but it's hard sometimes when, you know, and again, you'll notice the location of that call in front of Coach Lowry.
Graves fouling out with a season low, 5 points. Previously, it had been the 6 he had against Youngstown State and a big victory earlier. Tatum at the line.
Credit the Saluki defense.
17 points for Tatum. That's 3 better than his average. So if Faulkner forced to sit quite a bit, he's going to the bench again with all those fouls this afternoon. Tatum has picked up some of that scoring slack. He has 18. Campbell back on now for Butler. They need his 3-point shooting here in the last 2:27.
See, Campbell plays outside 3 anyway, and they'll probably put Curran out there to space it. So they might want to give Faulkner a little bit of a rest and get a better defender on the perimeter in for Butler, so 3-ball oriented.
Butler taking more than 250 more 3-pointers than their opponents coming into today. Green is held up. He's fouled. Mullins with the reach in. 2:16 on the clock. That's number 3 on Brian Mullins. Hey, coming up next, the O'Reilly ESPNU Bracketbuster as we continue with Northern Iowa against number 10 Nevada.
Get a look at Nick Fizikas, the John Wooden candidate, the All-American candidate from Nevada, Reno, out of Denver. I recruited him. I give the kid a lot of credit. He's had a terrific career. Good rebounder, unbelievable shooter.
Who do you look at as the next George Mason? Can such a thing be repeated by Nevada or by a team like this, Southern Illinois? How deep can they go?
Possibly Southern Illinois. I didn't know Tatum was as good offensively. It's very difficult, Dave, to assess a team totally on film. When I got to practice last night with you, I saw Tatum and how he can get to his own shot. And you remember last night, he's got a bad wheel. He spent half the practice riding the bike.
So he's got a bone bruise, yeah.
Yeah, but we knew at game time, he was going to come.
Mullins getting it back over to Tatum.
So consistent, so steady, Mullins.
He calls the timeout. Timeout. SIU here. Southern Illinois in command of the game, up 63-57.
But no way it's over. There's only a 6-point lead here.
We have a moment. Let's check in back in the studio with Scott Reese. Scott.
All right, Dave. Looks like a good finish over on ESPN. Indiana and Michigan. Wolverines desperately needing a signature victory clock, guys.
All right, Scott, thank you very much. Southern Illinois dreaming the dreams of the NCAA tournament. How about Bracketbuster teams and how well they did last season? Coach, there are 9 wins. Obviously, George Mason had all of those onto the Final Four, but 12 total teams made the NCAA tournament field were involved in Bracketbuster.
And none of those on our screen lost in the first round. There's so much parity out there, and these teams are well coached, come to play. Southern Illinois might be more athletic than the University of Illinois.
Mullins backing it out. I don't think I've seen anybody play defense. I mean, right down the roster, every guy out there, the way I've seen Southern Illinois play. And I'm talking about the Big East, the Big Ten, every game you and I have done this year. Here's Mullins, open for three. In and out, right before the shot clock. Still life for Butler, though. They still have a pulse here. Green jumps into paint. They swing it up top for Betko. Betko to Crone, a three. Yes!
Beautiful execution. Trusting the pass, sharing the ball, spacing the floor. Some of the fans behind us just got out of seats to come closer to the floor. Everyone's standing. This is the possession of the game right here. A stop here. Walker's out. It's going to be all Tatum.
Tatum bounces for Walker on the baseline. He lost it out of bounds. It's back over to Butler.
When I said he's out, he's not posted up. He's spaced out on the floor.
Southern Illinois turning it over for the 11th time. And a crucial one there, because now Butler has the ball and a chance to tie it up.
What a stop. And they're substituting Campbell back in. They're going make miss for offense, defense. Busey will come back in and they can get it on defense.
Remember, A.J. Graves is fouled out. Usually the best three-point shooter, although not today after taking ill. And his shooting numbers reflected that. He was 1 for 8. So here we come inside a minute. A three-point lead for Southern Illinois. Trying to hang on and knock off Butler. Crone on the drive. Tried the high glass. Shaw with the rebound. Ahead to Tatum.
He needed one more dribble, and then he needed the realization of a back dribble out. That was kind of a hope shot. Look at him move the ball here.
Stryker will foul Young with 32 seconds to play. And so Young will go to the line. One of the better foul shooters for Southern Illinois. And that's number 5 on Stryker, so he's fouled out.
Young just made the sign of the cross, and I'll tell you one thing about him. He is the toughest of tough here, and mentally tough as well. Very few guys are physically and mentally tough. This guy's in the high percentile of that category.
Tony Young, the senior.
I was watching the substitutions here, that's why.
So 32 seconds remaining. And Falker will again step to the bench. Well, now he is going to remain in. Looked like he was coming out, but he's going to stay on the floor.
Well, the rest of the rule didn't allow him to substitute because he wasn't up to the scorer's table in time to sub.
They want to get a substitute in for him. Young with a three-point lead for Southern Illinois.
Well, Falker's accustomed to coming to help defensively. I'm not accustomed to getting on the court playing the three ball.
64-60. And Butler's home court winning streak of 22 in a row. Just about a half a minute away from coming to an end. And Southern Illinois looking for a huge victory over the number 12 team in the country here at Hinkle Fieldhouse.
Southern Illinois defends the three best of all. That's why Butler's chances aren't very good right here.
27 seconds left, Rick. Here comes Green. It's Campbell off the around-the-back feed. He hit the deck. No foul there. Beasley with a tough rebound, and he's fouled in the lane with 20 seconds left.
What contact.
Joshua.
Hard-fought game.
Brian Mullins picking up the foul. I should say that's number 4 on him.
This is a game you don't want to see them. Former Indiana Pacer, the great George McGinnis, came over along with the governor of Indiana at halftime. Mitch Daniels, Bush's former budget director, and they were talking about what a great contest it was, how excited they were to be here. They're joined by 15,000 other fans.
Beasley, the freshman out of Freeport, Illinois. And
there's George on the left, the governor on the right. Oh, look at him. They're devising strategy. Maybe he's talking about the head count right there for the state relative to the cash and the walk-ups they had today. 500 admittees with cash only. I like that.
That game, by the way, Northern Iowa and Nevada is underway. Beasley made them both. 65-62. Butler in dire need of a steal here.
You got to look for a steal. Trap.
Oh, instead on Green from behind. That's his fourth. Another look.
They're playing it right. They're looking for a steal. Trap.
So Green picks it up. And Tatum getting ready to go back to the line, where he is 6 out of 9 in this one timeout. Butler trying to ice him a bit here with 20 seconds remaining. And Southern Illinois leading 65-62. Now tonight's schedule in the Bracket Busters, as mentioned, Northern Iowa and number 10 Nevada. That game is underway. Bradley, VCU coming up at 8 o'clock at 10. Drexel and Creighton. And at midnight, all the way to a new day, it'll be Ohio against New Mexico State.
So much at stake for those teams. They're each trying to play their way in. Here, they're trying to solidify a bid. Both these teams are in. You talk about not wanting to see a game end. It's this one. I've enjoyed this as much as any game you and I have had. It lived up to every expectation, particularly so on the effort scale and the unselfishness scale.
The question is, what will the final 20 seconds have in store for us at Hinkle Fieldhouse? Jamal Tatum back to the line.
There's two guys behind the bench over there that got to be in their 70s and up giving the rep the 1-4 with Butler jerseys on. Yeah. That's what you got to love about college ball. It's just so genuine.
Well, we are in Indiana. Tatum connects.
There they are right there. They sat down for a second. Look at them. Look at the expressions on their faces.
They are ticked.
They're too old to be parents of these players. So, you know, they're just got to be having fans. I'd like to go out with them after the game. I really would.
Tatum makes them both. He has 20. It's a 5-point lead. Here comes Green now. Butler has to hustle. It's down to 15 seconds remaining. Green on the baseline. Crone. He's fouled. Boy, did he want to make that one. He'll go to the line for two with just under 12 seconds left.
And they played it smart. They looked for the two. If they fell into the three, they were going to take it. They had the chance to get fouled. It's too bad he couldn't put it down. Green drives. I love Green. He's such a good passer, so crafty. He has to do so much, though. He's their glue guy. He's the reason they made him better.
Crone buries the first. Here comes Randall Faulker again. A.J. Graves is fouled out with just 5 points today, a season low.
Butler picked a lowly six, Dave, in the coach's preseason poll. Guess who did pick him number one? Coach Licklider. I like that.
Right now, they're number two behind Wright State.
All right, now. You don't want to foul. You want to see him get a steal.
Young trying to get it in. Had to call a timeout. So as not to turn it over on the violation. 11.8 seconds remaining. Both sides have one timeout left.
Here you want to spread the court. You want to come and meet the ball with your Southern Illinois. Ideally, you want to get the ball in the hands of who you perceive to be your best free throw shooter. And interesting enough, that's not always statistically the best. That's a mental toughness quotient. To me, I'm going with Young or I'm going with Tatum at this point in time. There may be a guy statistically who has it out there, and that would probably be Mullen. But at the end of the day, I know my personnel and my team, and I'm trying to speak with Coach Lowry right now. If you're Butler, you want to pressure the pass, go for a steal, take a chance and go for a trap, and then foul. Because if you foul right away with a 3-point lead, you're going to be so much at a disadvantage. Get an opportunity to get a steal or a 5-second call. Get an opportunity here to get another steal after you trap the inbounds pass. That's why you want to make them come and meet the ball. You don't want to let them go long.
Hey, tonight, Tyler Hansbrough and North Carolina will try and stay atop the ACC standings. They visit the Boston College Eagles. Coverage begins with College Game Day. That's driven by State Farm at 8 Eastern. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV on ESPN at 9 o'clock Eastern time. Look at the top five in the ACC. Some may be surprised, but it is Boston College at 9-3 right there with Virginia. North Carolina at 8-3. BC 18-7 overall.
And you know what the best backcourt is there? Virginia's, in my estimation. Singletary is really good, but the guy who doesn't get credit is Reynolds. He really plays smart. He plays off Singletary's penetration. He is a dogged defender.
All right, Southern Illinois trying to check it in. They had to call a timeout moments ago.
Now they got a center fielder here. They're going to look to try to face front, steal.
They did get it in. Yep, Mullins is fouled.
They got it to one of the guys they wanted to. And as we talked about, he statistically is their best foul shooter.
The foul on Pete Campbell is third. Campbell, who's had an outstanding day with 17 points for Butler. So far, it has not been enough. Shaw also had a very good day for the Salukis. Another kind of unsung hero in many ways. And that's because Fonker spent so much time on the bench where he continues to sit because of foul trouble. Two stars, really. A.J. Graves there for Butler. And Randall Fonker did not have as much to say about this game as we thought.
They give out a defensive award this year at Southern Illinois. They're going to have to give it to the team.
7 seconds left. Green dribbling it away. Lost the dribble and lost the ball. And that is going to do it. Southern Illinois has ended Butler's 22-game home court winning streak. And Southern Illinois has knocked off the Bulldogs today here at Hinkle by a final score of 68-64. Standout win for the Salukis as they upend the Bulldogs today in Indianapolis. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. It's Northern Iowa and Nevada coming up next. We'll take on ESPN News with a post-game extra coming up shortly. For Rick Majerus, I'm Dave O'Brien as we take it to Reno.